In the last couple of years, something remarkable has happened to the movie musical. The all-singing, all-dancing story of Boy Meets Girl made La La Land the Fred and Ginger musical for a whole new generation. It was followed by a sleeper hit that went on to take the world by storm, The Greatest Showman.
Ladies and gents, this is the moment you've waited for.
Between them, they've grossed almost $900 million and proved the movie musical can still be cinema gold dust. But to get to these peaks of success, the movie musical has had to be dramatically reinvented. When in 1977 John Travolta strutted his way through the streets of Brooklyn in Saturday Night Fever, it showed just how much the movie musical had to evolve to keep up with the times.
Saturday Night Fever straddles both light and dark, investigating the bleaker recesses of youth culture and the working class experience, whilst reveling in some of the most iconic dance sequences ever shot. And that would be the challenge for the modern movie musical as the Hollywood studio system collapsed around it. How to attempt something fresh and relevant for contemporary audiences while still staying true to its roots.
It's a dilemma that has challenged a whole host of filmmakers over the last 40 years. Each with their own unique solution. Rebellion.
That was my cue, like, fuck 'em, I'll do a musical.
Multiculturalism.
I said it's over, it's a hit.
And pure exuberance. Each helping to keep the form alive and high-kicking.
In this final episode, I'll be tracing the unlikely path the musical has taken through modern cinema to find itself back up at the top of the box office. Once again.
New York in the mid-70s. The last place you'd have expected the movie musical to make a resurgence. The city was close to bankruptcy, with over a million households dependent on welfare and crime levels soaring at an alarming rate.
This was no longer the landscape that Gene Kelly and Frank Sinatra had bounced into so confidently two decades before. These were now the mean streets of a new generation of filmmakers whose bleak, gritty and often violent dramas reflected a world which had lost any optimism for spontaneous song and dance.
When they come back in, they can put whatever, you know, featuring so-and-so, 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 so-and-so.
This new breed of directors were hailed as the saviors of American film. They were fiercely independent, self-professed auteurs. From Martin Scorsese's bleakly horrifying Taxi Driver to Francis Ford Coppola's epic Godfather.
I'm going to make him an offer again with you.
Their films were light years away from the great studio movie musicals of the 50s and 60s. Or were they?
There aren't very many numbers where you can just play the first opening three or four notes and everybody knows what they are.
Start spreading the news.
A truly iconic song, first brought to life with all the gusto of a classic movie musical diva by the great Liza Minnelli.
New York, these vagabond shoes.
The great New York, New York, written by Kander and Ebb for the film of the same name by Martin Scorsese. So full of confidence, so full of life. Picked up 2 years later by Frank Sinatra and made entirely his own. So how on earth did the mean streets of New York, on which the young Scorsese cut his teeth, end up producing something as emblematic as this?
Well, because deep down, Scorsese was an aficionado of the old-style Hollywood musical. New York, New York would be made as a loving homage to the halcyon days of big bands and even bigger sets.
First of all, I had in mind to recapture the way the old films were made. In other words, when I went to see films in the 40s, I saw what was supposed to be New York City on film, but in actuality, it was the back lot. That nightclub, the opening nightclub, is like all these other nightclubs all rolled into one and expanded a little more. In a sense, it was meant to be bigger than anything, you know. Yeah.
The film's female lead, Liza Minnelli, provided another nod to the MGM musicals of days gone by as her character moves from big band vocalist to movie star, including a full 12-minute film-within-a-film sequence that throws back to the unashamed glamour of the Golden Age. But if Scorsese had taken the musical back to its glamorous studio roots, his fellow auteur Francis Ford Coppola upped the game even further. With a glossy, meticulously staged extravaganza called One from the Heart. This was a triumph of cinematic showmanship. All the vibrancy and colour of a completely artificial Las Vegas lighting up the screen. Because not a frame of it was shot on location. Everything from the neon street scenes to the surely unnecessary recreation of not just a full-size plane, but an entire airport, was specially built from scratch at his new independent Zoetrope studio. Which meant almost every frame of One from the Heart, a classic tale of a tumultuous romance, is staggeringly beautiful. And this was a movie steeped in tradition, with lyrical, practically timeless melodies from songwriter Tom Waits, taking us straight back to the romance of the classical era. The timelessness was the problem. Despite their auteur directors, these films were an homage to a kind of cinema that the audience simply didn't connect with anymore. The landscape of the movies had changed. Audiences wanted Alien or Jaws, not some kind of Golden Age musical, no matter how much money had been spent or how big the stars involved. One from the Heart cost around $27 million to make and grossed less than $1 million, and threw Coppola's brand new studio into bankruptcy. And the lukewarm reception of New York, New York drove Scorsese into one of the darkest points of his career. The Raging Bull's almost note-perfect reverence for the past glories of the musical had been their undoing. Ironically, what had kept the musical afloat in the last few years had been a much more irreverent attitude to the classics of the past. And nowhere is this more evident than in one of my favourite scenes from all film history. Ladies and gentlemen, Mel Brooks's The Producers. The fantastically offensive climactic number of The Producers took the format of the Broadway Revue movie and from it created something truly and beautifully outrageous.
I wrote The Producers as a play. It's called Springtime for Hitler then. You know? And we went to Joseph E. Levine, and Levine said, I love it. Change the name. Jews are not going to put Hitler on the marquee. I said, OK, Jerry. You know? So I changed it to The Producers. And I was off and running, making movies.
Over the coming years, Brooks would prove himself a master of the musical form, jumping without warning from an otherwise knockabout comedy into a full-on Busby Berkeley-style revue with top hats and tails to boot.
Throw out your hands, stick out your tush, hands on your hips, give them a push.
I love movie musicals. They're so rare now. Well, I had a song in almost every movie.
Blazing Saddles, whilst not a full-on musical, threw in numbers with anarchic disregard for traditional genre divides.
Who can satisfy their lustful habit?
Particularly memorable is its parody of husky-voiced German-born film star Marlene Dietrich.
It turned out to be a remarkably memorable moment because of the genius of Madeleine Kahn. I mean, all I was doing was making fun of Marlene Dietrich, having fun with her. Oh.
They're always coming and going and going and coming, and always too soon. White girls, I'm tired.
What's great about that number, I'm tired, is that Madeleine scat sings against the tune. She does this incredibly bad, you know, singing along that Marlene Dietrich used to do. This kind of, you know, Germanic, you know, Teutonic voice. But the tune remains, remarkably memorable because of Madeleine's performance.
Released in 1974 to great acclaim, Brooks's Blazing Saddles affectionately parodied movie musicals of the past. But at exactly the same time, a different kind of nostalgia was in the air. One that was more heartfelt, more about recapturing a golden baby boomer age in America's recent history. It was masterminded by a fledgling Hollywood director who would soon go on to conquer the world with a movie called Star Wars. His name, George Lucas. His bright idea, to make music literally the driving force of his story, even if the cast weren't singing and dancing themselves.
American Graffiti! Where were you in 62?
Set on the night of a high school sock hop, American Graffiti skillfully replicated all the hallmarks of a classic vintage teenage movie with note-perfect visual and musical accuracy. Right through to its boy-meets-girl storyline and the continuous soundtrack straight out of a diner's jukebox.
Faced with the grim realities of Nixon's America in the 1970s, the baby boomer generation looked back to their own childhoods in the 1950s and 60s. If the movie musical was about escapism, why not take it back to its heyday, when times seemed sunnier, more innocent, more carefree?
On the surface, American Graffiti doesn't even read like a traditional musical. But the string of 50s and 60s hits coming from the car radios were the magic ingredient that knitted the film together. A new way of using music in the movies, with much-loved popular songs instantly signifying young love and heartbreak.
With its feel-good soundtrack and full-blown teen spirit, American Graffiti was instant box office gold. It cost less than $1 million to make and has gone on to date to earn more than $140 million, making it one of the most profitable films of all time.
For the 1970s movie musical, looking backwards was, in fact, the way forward. Nostalgia movies were all the rage. And this gave us one of the best-loved musical films of all time, Grease. Beginning life as a low-budget off-Broadway show, it was film that truly brought Grease to life. With screen sensation John Travolta on board, the movie transposed the setting to sunny Western California and threw its audience into a Technicolor 50s frenzy. Never mind that its actors were for the most part closer to their 30s than their teens, the film was a perfectly realized trip back in time. Its retro numbers were performed by a cast of James Dean lookalikes and high school bobby soxers.
It's just so different from music of today, something that's very much the 50s and the 50s only. Tell me more, what's the love and
you think the dances were better then?
Well, I don't know they were better. They were probably more fun then. Took a bowling in the arcade.
You can always look back with rose-coloured glasses and you know, the 50s has got a great thing about it. It's got leather jackets and DA haircuts and girls with big frocks. It's a good period.
Where the Americans had John Travolta, our own take on the 50s musical in the UK was fronted by a uniquely British heartthrob, David Essex. The UK had also been hit by the nostalgia bug. Facing challenging times in the mid-70s, with miner strikes, power cuts and the three-day week, we too were desperately in need of a bit of escapism. That'll Be the Day was a seamless blend of the past with the present, with 70s sensation Essex starring alongside Beatle Ringo Starr and real-life 50s sensation Billy Fury.
Well, That'll Be the Day was a proper British film. And there were no airs and graces. Most of the people in it had lived the life that they were playing. You know, they'd lived in the back of a van. So they knew the life.
The funfair where Essex works the Dodgems is a world away from the halcyon fairground of Greece.
Good night, Gov.
And the film doesn't shy away from promiscuity.
Are you coming?
I've got a room.
I've got a bike.
Leaving little to the imagination. But its soundtrack, just like Grease and American Graffiti across the pond, topped the charts, catapulting Essex to fame and the film itself to box office triumph. These 50s throwback movies were wildly popular and hugely successful. But they were literally backward-looking. So how could a contemporary musical be both popular and progressive? What we needed was a maverick.
There were a few people at the beginning, then Vivian...
The incomparable Ken Russell.
I think I am the saviour of the British film industry.
Known for being one of Britain's most notoriously flamboyant directors, Russell was finding innovative ways to blur the traditional lines between image and sound from the very beginning.
Bring up the cello now.
His groundbreaking documentaries for the BBC foregrounded music as an art form, often with almost no dialogue. No other television director dared to make films this way, so one could only imagine what this non-conformist would come up with when given a massive feature film budget.
And we've all got to be eating caviar and drinking champagne.
Russell's venture into the world of the movie musical would be controversial even before he'd shot a frame. In the early 70s, my favourite rock band, The Who, were touring the world's first ever rock opera, Tommy. I'm free. Singer Roger Daltrey acted out the central role of a deaf, dumb and blind kid who rises to fame as a messiah-like figure. So in 1975, the Wild Men of Rock and the Wild Man of British Cinema formed an unholy alliance that brought this provocative tale to the big screen with the help of one or two other rock gods. The most iconic scene in Tommy was shot here in Southsea's King's Theatre and was a performance of what, for my money, is one of the greatest rock numbers ever written. If you're going to do Tommy, Pinball Wizard has got to be a major moment. The album was huge and Pinball Wizard was known by everybody. And when Cam Russell came to shoot this, he grabbed it with both hands. He's a pinball wizard, there has to be a twist. Put in Elton John on his huge boots, standing behind a pinball machine that had a keyboard. And he filled this auditorium with adoring fans.
The result was one of the greatest moments in British movie musical history.
Tommy, released in cinemas with quintophonic sound, turned out to be Russell's biggest commercial success and hugely influenced filmmakers, video producers, and one Turner Prize winning artist.
People surprised when you tell them that Tommy's your favourite film.
People are surprised when I say it is. Ken Russell is a genius. His career was quite high at that point, wasn't it? So if he said, what if I could get 100 gallons of baked beans coming out of TV, I would say, OK, we'll do that. So he was in a position to make these crazy ideas a reality. It's like he's finally able to do what he's maybe been thinking about. For me, is the Eyesight to the Blind. That's the song that Eric Clapton sings. It's in the shot in the church. You talk about your woman. I wish you could see mine. Oh, yeah. That's for me is like the most outrageous thing I'd ever seen in my life. Using people who really had disabilities in the audience or congregation. You know her daddy gave her magic. I can tell by the way she walks. Tommy was one of the first musicals that told a very transgressive story in a very popular way, and people still love it, even though the subjects within it are almost taboo, something. With Tommy, he showed the world what you could do with music and what, visually, music could do on film.
Whether through warts and all nostalgia or flamboyant rock opera, both Tommy and That'll Be the Day gave a much-needed kick up the arse to a British film industry that in the mid-1970s was slipping into the doldrums. And it didn't end there. Russell wasn't the only UK movie maverick who saw the potential for making his name by reimagining the musical in a whole new fashion. Lousy! The following year saw commercials director Alan Parker make his feature film debut, a gangster drama, but with custard pie guns instead of bullets.
So this is show business?
And most uniquely, a cast made up entirely of children.
This is getting ridiculous.
The way that Bugsy Malone started out in life was that I had four small children at the time. So I started telling them this story. And then it was my oldest son who said, well, why can't kids be the heroes of the film? And so from that, I thought, well, actually, that's not a bad idea. It was his idea, not mine.
But what made Bugsy so memorable was its lovable 20s-style numbers. We couldn't fit anything that we wanted to be. A meeting of minds between Parker as director and maverick American songwriter Paul Williams.
First draft of Bugsy Malone, I wrote all the songs. I wrote them as little poems, really, as songs. And Paul Williams was inspired by that and completely ignored it, which works a treat. My name is Tallulah, my first rule of thumb.
I don't say where I'm going or where I'm coming from. It never felt like a kid's film to me. It was entertainment for kids, but I mean, if you listen to the songs, the lyrics are, you know, my name is Tallulah, my first rule of thumb, I don't say where I'm going and where I'm coming from. This little hussy is like, it's Jodie Foster. What was I thinking? It's a wonder they didn't lock me up, you know. I'll take what you give me and I
won't ask why. Paul Williams' job when writing songs for Bugsy Malone was to provide a bridge between the 1970s, when the film was released, and the 1920s, the Prohibition era, when it's set. And you can hear with this number, So You Want to Be a Boxer, very catchy number, exactly how he does that. First of all, a wonderful rhythm to kick off with. That's enough of a hook as it is, but then you get into the 20s bit where you get the jangly piano. So it becomes a very simple song to understand. But it's also wonderfully playful because the character Leroy, who's going to have to become this boxer, is being given everything that's awful about being a boxer. Put him in the ring, Joe, give the guy a chance. Let him feel the sting, Joe, we can make him dance. And the main thing is that he's going to be hitting the canvas again and again and again, and you can hear those punches going in the rhythm. Boom.
The instruments that I used to write it were the speed bag, you know, the rosin, you know, and the heavy bags.
Can you punch like a southbound freight train?
Took it right into the gym, you know.
Can you move in a word like a hummingbird's wing if you need to?
Ooh, that's fast.
Can you bob, can you weave, can you fake and deceive when you need to? Well, you might as well quit if you haven't got it.
I think that probably my philosophy is in Bugsy Malone. You know, you give a little love and it all comes back to you, you know. Which incidentally wound up as a Coke commercial along the way, so it did in fact come back to me.
Though set in Prohibition America, Bugsy Malone's success was in replacing violence with charm. But as the 1970s got more political, so too did the movie musical. This was the decade that coined the phrase blaxploitation, films that offered African-American audiences their own riffs on genre cinema, with characters and music that more truly reflected the cultural melting pot of present-day America.
He's got a plan to stick it to the man.
It was only a matter of time before someone thought of adding song and dance into the mix.
Superfly.
In 1976, Car Wash hit the screen, a low-budget feature with a predominantly African-American cast, something that was still almost unheard of for the Hollywood musical.
Studio wasn't going to make a musical. They wanted to do just the comedy. And so I told the producers, I said, okay, well, we'll make it a musical, but we won't tell them.
But Car Wash had an ace up its sleeve. The soundtrack would be written by one of the powerhouses of the Motown sound, Norman Whitfield, creator of hits for Marvin Gaye, The Four Tops, and The Temptations.
They said, would you mind working with Norman? I said, are you crazy? Norman is the best, you know, Motown writer on the planet. I said, Norman, before we start shooting, I need the Car Wash Ballet. Ballet? Instead of dance, it's people moving. We're going to see their characters as they come to work. Give me something that they can really groove to.
Hey, come on, folks. Hey, come on.
So after the first week of rehearsal in the studio, Norman plays the Car Wash theme. I said, it's over. It's a hit.
Car Wash is one of the few Hollywood musicals that actively embraces an entirely multiracial cast. But there's more to it than that. This is the movie musical of the gritty reality of blue-collar life in urban America, with its hard graft and its vibrant, bustling communities. Just listen to those opening lyrics. You may not ever get rich, but let me tell you, it's better than digging a ditch.
I wanted to show the complexity.
Hey, brothers, I'm here to unite with you.
I wanted to mix the reality that a lot of us were living in and growing up in and seeing around us with the plain joie de vivre, the plain joy of life, you know?
Some of those characters for their time are pretty challenging. I'm thinking particularly of Antonio Vargas's character.
Stand and deliver, honey.
Sweet, Lindy was, I think, the first cross-dresser African-American gay character.
One thing you can be sure of, Hippo, is when I'm around, your body is safe.
Maybe the first black gay character on screen, but very controversial. The thing I loved about that was the counterpoint between Abdullah, the revolutionary, and Antonio Lindsay.
She's just another poor example of how the system has her destroying our men.
Honey, I am more man than you'll ever be, and more woman than you'll ever get.
Had so many good comebacks from a humanity standpoint, and that was way ahead of its time.
This was a whole cultural shift in the movie musical, where a classic like The Wizard of Oz could be imaginatively restaged as The Wiz, an African-American cult classic with music from Quincy Jones, starring Diana Ross and Michael Jackson. Dancing their way along a bold new yellow brick road, through an Oz that looks a whole lot like urban New York City. Car Wash and The Wiz celebrated the fact that in an increasingly diverse world, lovely tunes, romance and escapism were simply not good enough.
Who wants to go to a fucking school to learn to dance anyway?
The movie musical was toughening up. So when Alan Parker set out to make Fame, his first venture into American cinema, he happily embraced the stark reality of urban America.
That really was more the fashion of the times, really, rather than any movie that had gone before. It was about a whole period of directors who wanted to get out of the studio, really, and to get onto the real streets.
The majority of the film was supposedly set in the real-life High School of Performing Arts in Manhattan, but once they saw Parker's script, the New York Board of Education refused him permission to darken their portals.
Later this time. Get Annie, instead of coming across, to come upwards, okay? Because at the moment she's blocking him right at the very beginning.
It reflected Parker's attraction to the underbelly of the American dream, and along with edgier musicals like Saturday Night Fever, explored youth culture in a more honest and adult way. Its teenage cast had a lot more than dance rehearsals on their minds.
You people make a big deal about pulling us out of the gutter, and yet you still won't eat with us. You know where that leaves people like me? Nowhere.
Parker's film was rough and ready, most notably in its famous chaotic dance scene, which took its cast into the streets of New York and almost brought the city to a standstill. Although originally this sequence was lacking one crucial element.
We hadn't actually written the Fame song at that point. So the whole thing, 3 days we shot with Donna Summer, Hot Stuff, belted out on the speakers, and the whole thing was done to that. About 2 weeks later, Michael Gore wrote the song Fame.
In one central dance scene, the authenticity and vibrant multiculturalism of the 70s musical is there for all to see.
I heard you on the wireless back in 52.
But shot on the cusp of the 80s, it also resonated with a new cultural phenomenon that was inherently changing the way that the world watched song and dance.
When MTV launched in the US in 1981, suddenly movie musicals in miniature with very high production values were beamed into people's front rooms 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. It completely changed the way audiences expected song and dance to look on screen. Video may have killed the radio star, but it completely transformed the movie musical.
In films like Flashdance, it was clear that the lesson learned from MTV was to take the Golden Age MGM musical and pump up the volume in every sense. Dance sequences ever more heavily stylized and lighting like a stadium rock concert.
But this wasn't just about feature films replicating the music video for the sake of it. Over 60% of MTV viewers went to see a film at the cinema because a video from it had played on the channel. And record companies and film studios alike realized they could use the music video to their advantage. With it,
They could sell the film and the soundtrack.
Footloose took this tactic into overdrive, with most of the songs written after the film had been shot and edited to resemble a feature-length music video. It was an aesthetic that audiences were now tuned into. The video for Kenny Loggins' title track was aired on MTV weeks before Footloose premiered, and its star Kevin Bacon was being mobbed by teenage fans long before they actually saw the completed film. And it worked, with Footloose scoring 6 top 40 singles and recouping its budget within the first weekend of release. It was another sharp survival tactic for the movie musical, and there was more to come.
Britain too had fallen under the spell of the MTV pop promo, but as it turned out, that old 50s nostalgia bug was back in the air too. A trio of long-forgotten novels by an author called Colin McInnes, dealing with the smoky past of Soho's jazz clubs, had become required reading for 80s hipsters who rejected the flashy gloss of MTV. And it would only be a matter of time before the best loved of these, Absolute Beginners, would be turned into a movie.
The man chosen to direct this eagerly awaited evocation of the 1950s was himself a veteran of the pop promo, Julian Temple. Temple had made a name for himself documenting punk legends The Sex Pistols and working with a whole raft of music legends from The Kinks to David Bowie. Absolute Beginners was his big break into feature film, a lavish extravaganza of street life in all its technicolor glory.
I did make the decision to make the musical out of the book because he said, very early in the book, describing a summer's night on Shaftesbury Avenue in 1958, he said, one day they'll make musicals about this. So that was my cue, like, fuck them, I'll do a musical.
Temple's musical was loud and bold, with old pal David Bowie, and overblown sets that would have made Busby Berkeley proud.
I reveled in the fact that they were really unhip and you were not meant to like them. I think, you know, it's such an extreme form of cinema. I think interesting directors would possibly be drawn to it, which was probably the reason for my fatal error of making a musical out of Absolute Beginners, because I just thought, well, what can be more punk than making a musical, really?
But this was no low-budget punk experiment. With sets that were the biggest built in Britain since Hitchcock in the 1930s, Absolute Beginners was intended to be a blockbuster, a huge investment for a British film industry hoping to compete with the big guns of Hollywood.
We solved that problem by making the mistake of hyping the movie to death up front. I mean, to get this movie made, we had to show them the front cover of The Face, the NME, say, look, they're writing about Colin McInnes, this is a really hip idea, this Absolute Beginners thing, and I've got David Bowie, and I've got... Yeah. And all these things to shove under their noses.
Tomorrow night witnesses the most hyped British film premiere of the year.
The film, a musical about the 50s, has cost £8 million to make and has been billed as the great hope for the British film industry.
When the film came out, it was already like a national cause célèbre. People were kind of fed up with it because we'd been yapping about it for so long. So we cut our own throat.
Over £1 million over budget before filming even began, the critical backlash on its release was the final nail in the coffin of both Absolute Beginners and the British mega musical.
Musicals, I think, aren't very expensive and they're easy to get wrong.
All I want is a quiet life. Absolute Beginners was perhaps ahead of its time. Its visual ambition and quirky set pieces hold up very well today. When I can just stay afloat. It indicated that as the 80s moved towards the thoroughly sceptical 90s, the movie musical would need another reinvention. Or perhaps a reanimation. The movie musical had stayed alive and well with Disney's great films of the 50s and 60s, But by now, the Disney company had begun to focus more on money-spinning theme parks than on tuneful and slickly animated movies.
Folks on the dock, please step right in behind me.
But after a string of box office disappointments, the studio decided that enough was enough. In a bid to reclaim Disney's place at the top of the movie musical canon, they decided to go back to the formula of the company's heyday, taking fairy tale and folklore stories, which they could retell through animation, and most importantly, through song. And for these, they brought in a team fresh off the success of their cult rock comedy, Little Shop of Horrors, who would create a whole new standard for the animated family blockbuster, lyricist Howard Ashman and composer Alan Menken.
Disney was in a state of flux at that point. Most people did not want to be necessarily involved in animation. Animation was considered to be sort of dead at that time. People in the business said, oh man, take a powder. Nobody takes animated scores seriously.
Little did they know.
Ariel, listen to me. The human world.
Menken and Ashman's first animated film, The Little Mermaid, proved to be the savior of the movie musical, with an unlikely crustacean maestro.
They wanted a stuffy English court conductor, which Ed Howard said, you know, it would be so much fun if we could go in a more sort of Caribbean direction. Also, Howard wanted a riff that kind of would circle on his... So it could just go around. The seaweed is always green, a very rhythmic...
You dream about going up there, but that is a big mistake. Just look at the world around
you. So you just give it a really rhythmic, fun, ebullient moment. You knew the animators were just going to explode, so you give them as much as possible to, you know, the new blade, the flute, the carp blade, the harp, the bass blade, the bass, and they sound the sharp, the bass blade, the brass, the chop blade, the top.
The flute is the duke of soul.
Yeah. The images are just racing at you. Yeah, it's amazing.
Menken and Ashman's skill was in using song to invest their animated characters with the emotional complexity of Broadway stars.
What would I give?
Seen most clearly in Ariel's big moment, Part of Your World, where her inner yearning for life on land and arguably mature womanhood is revealed.
Smiling at me. I remember reading a wonderful line that you gave, which was, we were no less adult with the Little Mermaid than we were with Little Shop of Horrors.
I'm totally, totally. You're dealing with a protagonist and you're dealing with a want. This is a girl who wants to be over there, it's, you know. And God knows that's a classic element of so many musicals. In this case, she's a mermaid who wants to be, you know, on land.
The Little Mermaid ushered in a new golden age for the animated family film, from Beauty and the Beast to Pocahontas, and made Menken one of the most prolific Oscar winners of all time.
It's what's become known as the Disney Renaissance, the family animation embracing the modern musical and taking it forward for a new generation.
These films may have been family-friendly, but at their heart they dealt with deep universal themes, love, loss and heartbreak, that belied their cartoonish exteriors.
Dad? Dad, come on.
To infinity and beyond!
And this move towards more psychologically complex animated characters would be continued by a group of children's toys with grown-up personas in the first feature-length film from the soon-to-be internationally acclaimed animation giant, Pixar.
When somebody loved me, everything was beautiful.
You might not think of the Toy Story films as musicals, but songs have always played an irreplaceable part in their storytelling.
She was sad, I was there.
And this is down to the work of bona fide genius Randy Newman, whose songs used in so many Pixar films take us deep into the human minds of these animated characters.
Here's a songwriter draws on Americana. So his songs feel like they could have come from 80, 100, 120 years ago. They sound timeless and so he makes timeless comments. So with Buzz Lightyear's wonderful moment in which he realizes he's a toy and not a real astronaut, we have this. Feels timeless. And why? Because it's bringing in not just the children into this story, but the adults too. Because, of course, Buzz can't fly. He falls with a trademark wry comment from Randy.
Clearly I will go sailing no more.
And all of us of whatever age are drawn into the film because Buzz has had to realise something we've all had to realise, which is life is about falling with style. And that's what's so clever about Randy Newman and what makes the Toy Story films particularly work as well as they do. Time and again, we're told about us, not about those characters. These family films provided a pathway back to everything that we once unashamedly loved about classic musical films, and offered up a glimmer of opportunity for the more idealistic, surreal live-action musical of the good old days. This side of the millennium, filmmakers have been once again putting the musical to work, but in our globalised landscape, this new renaissance has become a worldwide movement, mixing genres and cultures in a series of modern and very musical mashups. In Australia, Baz Luhrmann took all the glossy abandon of MTV culture and pushed it one step further, creating the hallucinatory Moulin Rouge. Blending reworkings of mainstream popular music with countless references to classic musicals of the past, he revelled in combining the old with the new.
Outside it may be raining, but in here it's entertaining.
In Japan, where cinema, anime and pop culture go hand in hand, there was space for bat-crazy black comedy musicals like The Happiness of the Katakuris, billed as The Sound of Music meets Dawn of the Dead. Coco pulled off the trick of being both a magnificent celebration of Mexican culture and a life-affirming film about death.
He lived the kind of life you dream about.
Its Oscar-winning central number proved that Pixar is still the master of the animated showstopper.
I used to live half of my life in the Soviet Union. And the first position was musical. You know, the genre you'll never go to the theater to see, to watch, never. The second was Western, you know, in Russia. And all my friends said to me, Valery, just forget about it. You know, it's bullshit. It's a tragedy. It's money wasting for nothing, nothing. But, you know, sometimes you have to be brave. You have to risk.
India. Since the 1970s, the hugely popular Bollywood genre had continued to blossom and thrive with ever more daring song and dance routines. And perhaps no individual number has garnered such international admiration for its daredevil staging and dramatic vistas than the railroad song Chaya Chaya from the film Dilse.
That song sequence influenced a lot of people around the world, and the influence is through dance and music. They're on this little train. The camera work is fantastic. The performance is very good. The dancers are very good. And the choreography is really brilliant. It's everything. And the words of the song also mean something. It's a Sufi song. So it's more about divine love, even though they're dancing away, it's about divine love. So all those things made it a very unique, and nobody thought of it before. I saw the Spike Lee film Inside Man, and the credit sequence has this music. And they were two young women with hijabs on, and the minute they heard this song, they jumped up and said, Shah Rukh!
Shah Rukh Khan, also known to fans as King Khan, is arguably one of Bollywood's brightest shining stars.
And I honestly believe it's the star that brings the audience in.
Charisma, nerve and talent, all wrapped up in his scene-stealing performances in 2007's Om Shanti Om.
In order for a film to do really big business, you have to appeal to a lot of people and from north to south. And now the people of Indian origin, Pakistani, Bangladeshis living all around the world, they must all love the film.
King Khan's star power enabled him to enlist almost every major current Bollywood star for Om Shanti Om's most celebrated number, Divangi Divangi, the highlight of a film that both parodied and celebrated the Hindi film industry and cashed in at the box office. Bollywood may have been striding from strength to strength through the 21st century, but back in Hollywood, still no one really had the courage to create a completely original live-action blockbuster musical. But that was about to change.
We're in a good old LA freeway tailback. There's no way you could kick off a musical in this day and age from something as mundane as this, is there? Is there?
Despite its modest surroundings, the first scene of Damien Chazelle's La La Land would make clear that this modern-day musical planned on hitting the ground running.
We knew that it's our first number, right? So either, like, if we do this right, people will be, like, invested, and they're going to be like, we love La La Land. If I do it wrong, they're going to get up and leave. I was so stressed. He really wanted to make sure that the dance evolved. This musical had to be all about that transition from normal person to dancer. I hear them every day. New rhythms in the canyons that'll never fade away. And that it should happen before your eyes, and you should kind of not even know that it happened, and then before you know it, people are dancing. So I bang on every door. And even when the answer's no. That film was all about the bridge. How do you go from normal Joe to Dancing Joe? You know, had two days, which is crazy, 2 days of rehearsal with the dancers. I don't know if you remember when the skateboarder jumped down, it was like right on the beat. That was on set. I was laying under a car and I would have to count him down. 5, 4, 3, 2, jump! And he'd be like, nah, boom, and he'd make it.
The dance numbers in La La Land, shot from head to toe, usually with few or no cuts, were a knowing homage to the Golden Age. And the film's high-profile success would usher in a flurry of studio interest in the blockbuster musical. At the centre of this renaissance were the film's lyricists and the two new giants of movie songwriting, Pashek and Paul. They had hit the big time with La La Land. But their next gig was a show on a whole different scale. Giving 19th century circus showman P.T. Barnum a very modern makeover.
At the time, the only writers that they were talking to were all people pop, who wrote yeah. pop songs. So we were kind of trying to just get in the mix.
So there was definitely like a learning curve and a deep dive into like, you know, the director was like, yeah, okay, let's work together. And we were like, do we know how to write pop music? It was very much his vision to go along with the idea of Barnum being ahead of his time, being this sort of innovative figure and icon of entertainment. The idea that when these characters open their mouths to sing, you're not hearing it in you know, 1890s pastiche style, but you're really, the music feels contemporary and feels urgent and relevant.
The soundtrack proved itself to be more than relevant, breaking record after record and overtaking Saturday Night Fever as the UK's longest continuous chart-topping soundtrack album since the 1960s. But the film's producers were clear from the start that it would need a standout central anthem.
There were many, many times during the pre-production, or I guess the development of The Greatest Showman, where we were told that the studio didn't, you know, feel confident in making this film, and if we didn't write this one number or this big anthem, everything was going to fall apart and it wasn't going to get made. So we literally end up flying to Los Angeles with maybe like a verse written.
The rehearsal, frankly, was a little bit worrisome. And then Kayala in the workshop, she was sort of terrified to sing the song, and we were like, hey, you know, like, go for it. Like, we couldn't say, like, girl, we're depending on you. But that was the head of the studio came up to her and was like, hi, I don't know who you are. Because they're just Broadway actors, and they're like, I don't know what that is. She's like, I don't know who you are, but
you just booked your first major motion picture.
You're going to be in this movie.
Yeah.
Love it or hate it, This Is Me has been the song of 2018 that you just can't escape. The very beginning. Moments that can put a spring in our step.
It's about that feeling that you can try and create between two people and that conversation they can have without ever saying a word.
And a smile on our face.
Gene always said, don't imitate what I do, take what I do and go beyond it.
Numbers that continue to inspire us and become timeless classics.
If you're willing to surrender to that moment, you know, you can be watching your first movie musical and loving it.
The movie musical has done an amazing job of moving with the times, evolving to satisfy audiences throughout its 90-year history. And I think that's because the movie musical is, at heart, a method of channeling moments of pure joy. And we carry those moments with us in the hope that maybe one day real life may turn out to be just as joyous.